grab all your bulletin and you go get another one. Good morning and welcome to worship today. This is the day the Lord has made. And so we are here to rejoice and be glad in the opportunity to give thanks and praise to God today. So I'm going to take this off so this is not recorded for posterity. That's going to trigger some problems. So we're going to have to call it something else. I don't know. Probably it'll end up being OZ Chapel. And, you know, so that it doesn't trigger alarm somewhere. So OCC Church, I don't know what it's going to be. But it's got to be something that'll sneak under the radar. At Facebook. So that's how life is. You can still watch on YouTube. For some reason, YouTube and Facebook do not talk to each other, so we're not banned from YouTube. So anyway, and I should have said this before. I better. So, in reading lots of the commentary on why we got banned, most of them said, you know, we really don't have a good reason, don't see anything, there's no obvious reason that you get banned. It's just something they do every so often to clean up the place. I don't know what that means. So, anyway, it doesn't make much sense, but that's what happened. So, we're not live on Facebook anymore. But we are live on YouTube, so. Good morning to those that are watching on YouTube this morning. I'm glad you found us and are here. The announcements are printed in your bulletin this morning, and I believe we have, yes. That is Wednesday, April 10th at noon. Jeff Green from the Stop Human Trafficking Coalition here at the lake will be speaking. The other announcements are printed in your bulletin this morning. Once again, welcome. It's good to see all of you on this first Sunday after Easter. I invite you with me to bow now and let us quiet our hearts and remove all other thoughts as we give thanks to God. Today, Lord God, as we worship you, as we are gathered here to praise your name, Lord God, all praise and honor and thanksgiving belongs to you, Lord God. And so we give thanks today. Thank you for your love and your mercy. Thank you for our brothers and sisters gathered together, thank you that you are present with us at all times. And so in your mighty name today, it is that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Would you please join me and stand for the call to worship and remain standing for our first song? The tomb is empty and darkness has lost. We dance in the light of his resurrection. No more do we have to fear. No more does worry reign. He is victorious and so are we. Because of his victory, we are free. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Join us as we sing the Day of Resurrection this morning. Let's sing all three verses. Around you and welcome them today in the name of the Lord.
And would you join me in the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen. And now bow with me. God has been good to each one of us, and so today we offer our lives and we pray for his consecration on us. Lord God, you have been merciful and kind. You have been good. You pour out your riches on us. And so we give thanks to you. But beyond just giving thanks, we pray that you would take us and use us. Even as you have blessed us, that you take our time and our talents, our gifts and our service, our witness, that we might make a difference in the world, that we might have a positive impact on lives around us, that we might stand for righteousness and goodness in the world. And so take us and use us today as your children. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Good morning. I'll be reading John 21, 1 through 14. This is about Jesus and the miraculous catch of fish. After Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee, it happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood at the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
This first song is "I Will Rise." This is about the peace that we have because of Jesus died on the cross, and then he raised from the dead and gave us this peace that he has overcome and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won and he has risen from the dead. Thank you, Jesus, for the peace that you give us.
Know my heart and soul, I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise.
Next song is "Oh Come to the Altar." A lot of us are hurting and we're broken inside. A lot of us feel that there's no alternative to what we have here in this church and in our lives, but there is. I meet a lot of those people on the street, and we're very fortunate here to have what we have, but I'm telling you, there is life in Jesus Christ. We just need to look forward and to explain to these folks that don't have in their lives. So let's go forward. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling.
Amen.
Is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open. Thank you.
your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Amen.
The second scripture reading is Luke 24:13-35. Now that the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were taking with each other about everything that had, or talking to each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleophas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They ask each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while we talked with him on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way, and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. It is time now for the kids to go to children's church. So off you go today.
Bye, Grandma.
Bye. Will you, oh, got a couple more going. Bye. Bye-bye. Will you bow with me as we come before the Lord in prayer today? So, Lord Jesus, we are here before you this morning. We humbly come into your presence to sing your praise, to acknowledge you, and to call upon you in prayer. We come today to hear your word proclaimed and read. We come today to receive communion and remember your great sacrifice for each one of us. And so as we worship you, we are so blessed and assured that your presence is here with us. And so thank you, Lord God, for speaking to us, for ministering to us, for hearing all of our pleas and concerns, our stresses and worries, the things that are upon our heart. We pray, O Lord, that you would move in a mighty way in our community to glorify your name, that all men and women might acknowledge and know that you are the Savior of the world. And so, Lord Jesus, move in hearts today. We pray, O Lord, for those who are ill and sick. We pray for those who battle cancer. We pray, Lord God, for every need represented in our congregation today. Bring healing for body, soul, and spirit. And now, Lord Jesus, as we worship you, it is with one heart and one mind that we pray to you as you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Please stand with me if you are able, and it's not too uncomfortable. Stand with me. Let us sing Because He Lives, number 364. It's on the screen. We give thanks to God because He lives today. Amen.
Worth the living just because He lives.
Amen. You may be seated. This is Communion Sunday, and let me just say this, that we serve open communion. All are invited to the Lord's table, and so we are here today to receive communion. After my message, we will, as a community, partake. All of you are welcome to come and receive as you will. Why did Jesus come? Why did he enter into the world? Why did he descend from heaven and become a human being? Why did he do that? If you get in your car, and I suppose if you get in your car, you usually have a destination before you get in, right? I mean, if you are here, you rarely probably get in your car and just drive around for the fun of it. I suppose you could, you do, but most of the time when you get in your car, you're on the way to church. You're on the way to the supermarket. You're on the way to the doctor's office. Can I have an amen there? You are on the way to somewhere, and there may be some places you stop off on the way, like the gas station or the grocery store or wherever it is, Dollar General. You may stop off somewhere, but you have a clear idea where you are going and what it is that you will do when you arrive. I am going to the doctor's office, and I'm getting my annual checkup, and when that's done, I'm going to go home and take a nap. Whatever it is that you do. But you have a clear understanding of where you're going, and we believe, we know that Jesus had a clear understanding of where he was going from the beginning. It just didn't happen by accident. He didn't just wander around until somebody said, "We don't really like what you're doing and we're going to crucify you." That wasn't by accident. And so this morning I'd like to read this passage of scripture from Matthew chapter 20. Here it is. Now let me back up and tell you what the context of this is. Jesus has headed towards Jerusalem. They've left Jericho and they're walking uphill for 20 miles. And they are going uphill, going to Jerusalem. It's Passover time. They have a destination. The disciples don't know that Good Friday's coming and Easter is to follow. But they are nonetheless walking uphill, stopping every so often to catch their breath, to rest. And they are walking to Jerusalem. And along the way, there are some women along the way with them. And along the way, James and John's mother, if you don't want to do it yourself, get your mom to do it. James and John's mother comes to Jesus and says, pulls him aside and says, "Can I have a word with you? Can I ask you a favor?" And you know what you do when people ask you a favor? You say, "Tell me the favor and I'll tell you what the answer is," right? So she says, "Can I have a favor?" And then Jesus says, "Well," and she says, "When you get to your kingdom, when you get to the place where you reign," now she thought, and the disciples had some thought, that they were going to Jerusalem so that he could be crowned king and then he would lead an uprising against the Romans and they would defeat the Romans, of course, and they would all get to reign. So she comes and says, "When you get to your kingdom, can my son James sit on one side and my son John sit on the other side?" And Jesus says to her, kind of mysteriously, Jesus says, "I don't think you really know what you're asking. Can you drink the cup that I will drink. Ooh, that's kind of cryptic. Can you drink the cup that I will drink? And Jesus kind of leaves it there, and Mom disappears from the picture. If you're following the story, Mom disappears from the pictures, and the sons are left there, and they say, "Of course we can drink. Whatever you drink, whatever you go through, Jesus, whatever you have to do, we are right with you." And Jesus might have, I mean, if it wasn't so sad, if it wasn't so depressing, if it wasn't so, you know, death looms on the horizon, if it was, I'm sure Jesus would have smiled and said, "Yeah, you don't know what you're asking." And Jesus says these words to the disciples. He says, "Yes, you will drink the cup, but to sit on my right hand and on my left hand, that is up to God, and he will have people sit on the right and the left who God wants to sit on the right and the left." Now, there are 10 other disciples, right? And they must have overheard this conversation, and they didn't like it. Can you imagine that? All of a sudden, here John and James, with the help of their mother, trying to get the best plum spots, and they are upset, and they say, "Jesus." And they're upset, and they're angry, and they're hurt, and Jesus then responds with these words. "Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Now, I was working on my sermon this week, and I don't know why I get dragged into these things, but I was reading in Facebook, and one of my old parishioner, you know, I didn't always serve Ozark Chapel, right? So there's been other churches that I've served, and one of the parishioners, one of my congregations, one of the people that was in the church, and I would say we were, well, we weren't like this, but we were at least like that, you know. Somebody I knew well put up a post that was hateful towards another group of people, calling on vengeance, fire from heaven to come down and destroy those people that are invading the United States. Now, I don't want to make a political statement, but I do want to talk about Jesus. And then I just couldn't help myself, so I responded and I said, "I wonder if when you get to the pearly gates, Jesus is going to respond in the same way you responded towards your neighbor, towards your brother and sister." It got very quiet. Some other lurker like me read that and said, "Well, Jesus never said we should be anyone's doormat." And I left it there, at least for 10 minutes. And it got quiet, you know, and I thought about it, and I thought about it. And finally, you know, I was working on my sermon, and I was looking at this verse. I was looking at this, that that one up there. See that? I was reading that verse. The Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve. And whoever wants to be first in the kingdom of God must be your slave. Jesus came, and let me just, Jesus came that he might serve. Jesus came and he humbled himself. He gave up his crown in heaven. He gave up his throne. He gave up his power. He gave up the people who were, the angels who were serving him. Every need Jesus had, every wish that he had when he was sitting on his heavenly throne was taken care of by the host of heaven. Amen? Everything in creation bows and worships and gives obedience to the King of Kings. And he gave it up. He stepped down from his throne and humbled himself and became a human being and walked on this earth to go to the cross. Now, I forgot to put it on this morning, but every day except today, I wear a cross around my neck. And it's a pretty silver cross that I got in the Holy Land. And, oh, it's, you know, I probably paid 5 times what it's really worth, but who cares? I got it in the Holy Land. I got it in Bethlehem, and I wear that proudly around my neck. And many of you wear crosses around your neck, amen? And I see people all the time. I don't know about you, but if you have a tattoo with a cross on it, I like to see it after worship, okay? But there are lots of people who have crosses on their arms and on their legs, and they wear crosses around your neck. You know, nobody in the time of Jesus would have ever dreamed of wearing a cross. Not as a tattoo. And not as jewelry. The cross in the time of Jesus was an instrument of torture. It was an instrument of pain. It was an instrument that told other people not to do whatever that criminal did who died on the cross. Remember, Jesus was crucified with 2 thieves. They were dying because they had stolen. Capital punishment. They were crucified on hills. They were crucified in plain sight, though that everybody walking by would see the extreme agony they were going through and know, do not do that lest the fate of that person fall on you. Do not steal, or you'll be crucified. Do not kill, you will be crucified. Do not. And so they executed Jesus because they didn't like his message. They didn't like the implication of what he was saying to them. They didn't want to be a slave. They didn't want to be a servant to all. They liked their power. They liked their money. They liked their wealth. They liked their status in the community. They didn't want to be a slave. And so they crucified him. Now let me just talk a little further about that. Just imagine somebody put a nail through your... Now, we usually talk about palms, right? They probably didn't put it through the palm. They probably put it right here below the palm because, just think about it for a second, if you put it through here, then when you're hanging on the cross, you might tear that nail out. So they likely put it right here in the wrist between those two bones that may, now I don't know what those bones are called, but you know there's two bones right in here, and it goes between it so that when you're hanging with your weight on there, it doesn't rip the nail out. They want you to suffer and hang. And then your feet were crossed and nailed so that your legs are a little bent like this, and your feet are up flush against the crossbar like that, and your legs are bent a little. You know why? Because when you're hanging on the cross, if you hang too long like that, how many of you can do a pull-up? Well, think about doing pull-ups for hours on end, and after a while, you just don't have the strength to do a pull-up anymore. And this gets kind of gross and kind of, but your chest and your muscles in here get stretched out to the point where it collapses your lungs. And so your lungs are pushed together and you can't breathe, and your arms, you're hanging on your arms. So the way you can breathe is by pushing up on your feet, right? You push up on your feet to relieve the pressure on your arms so that you can breathe. Now, just let me note in the scripture, you know this. They came and checked out because it was getting late in the day, and the next day, Good Friday, the next day would be the Sabbath, and that for the Jews was a holy day. They didn't want him hanging on the cross on the holy day, so they came and checked to make sure they were dead. And the thief on the right and the thief on the left weren't, so they broke their legs. Now think about that for a moment. No longer can you push up on that, so you die of asphyxiation, not bleeding to death. You die because you can't breathe anymore. Jesus died because he couldn't breathe anymore, not because he bled to death. It is the most horrific way to die you can possibly imagine. And Jesus humbled himself and came to the cross for your sins and mine. He came and humbled himself and became a complete servant. He became a doormat that you might have life. That when we come to this communion table, when we receive his body and his blood, you might be forgiven of all your sins and cleansed. That you might have an opportunity to reside in the kingdom now and forevermore. You're part of the kingdom today because of what Jesus did on the cross. You are part of his children, you are one of his disciples because of what he did on the cross for you. He humbled himself and became a slave. And so we come to this moment this morning, brothers and sisters, thankful for what Jesus chose to do. Wasn't an accident. He wasn't forced into it. He willingly gave his life for me and for you. Now, here's the other part of this. I don't understand this. I can't wrap my mind around it. It's too deep for even me to understand. But he did it not only for his disciples, but even for those who crucified him. Father, forgive them. They know not what they're doing. Can you imagine that? Somebody puts you on a cross and kills you and uses you in the most unpleasant, torturous way. And from the cross, you say, I forgive you. I don't hold this against you. Brothers and sisters, Jesus' great gift is a gift for all humanity. Now, let me just say that we went to Silver Dollar City yesterday, and one of my favorite things in the whole world is those cinnamon rolls right near the door. And, you know, we always go in, and I always say to the girls when they were growing up, free sniffs. You can have a free sniff. You know what that means? We're not buying any stinking cinnamon rolls. You have to smell it, but then we're on our way. You can't have one. They're there for anybody to take, right? They're there for anybody to have. They're there for anyone to sniff. They're there for anybody to taste, but you got to be willing to take it. You got to be willing to receive it. Jesus died on the cross for all of us, but brothers and sisters, we need to come to the point in our lives where we're willing to receive it. And so we come to this table. I'm going to offer it to all of you. Do you want to receive it? Do you want to take part? You have that opportunity in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Pray with me. Lord God, now consecrate these elements. Let them be for us your body broken on a cross, your blood spilled for each one of us. Today we come remembering your great sacrifice that you humbled yourself and allowed humanity to take you wherever they wanted to. You allowed humanity to crucify you on a cross that you might turn that into a mighty gift, the gift of life. And so we come to this table, O Lord, to receive your body and blood that we might have life. Both now in this world, that you would be with us every day, that you would guide our steps, that you would teach us your path, Lord God, every day, and then with the blessed hope for eternity. In the name of the Father who sent his only Son into the world, in the name of the Son who humbled himself and was willing to take a cross, in the name of the Holy Spirit who dwells in us. Amen. If those who are assisting would come at this time. On the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said to his disciples, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the supper was over, he took the cup and offered it to his disciples and said, this is my blood poured out for you and for many. Do this today in remembrance of me. And so we come today to this, the table of the Lord, remembering the cross which sits on this table, that it is a light to the world. And so let us receive with thanksgiving. Take your glove. Go ahead and serve everyone. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Do this in remembrance of him. This is the blood of the new covenant. Do this today in remembrance of Jesus. Come now, come down the center aisle as you will and receive. If you are unable, they will be honored to come and serve you in your seats. Thank you.
to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and grant you peace. Amen. There is a board meeting today at 6 p.m. So this evening at 6 p.m. right here, all are welcome. God bless you and have a great week.